best of us.
Amen. Hallelujah. How many knows that it is good to come to the come together in the house of the Lord for worship? Amen. Even when the storms are rumbling and tumultuous outside, it can be just as calm and peaceful in here. Amen. Because we know the one that calms those storms. Amen. Stand on your feet and let's go to God in worship tonight. He definitely is majestic. He is great in power, great in all his ways. Amen. And he is nearer to our hearts. Amen. He's ready, willing, and able to meet our needs tonight. Whatever you may have come in the doors with, just worship him and give him your all. Hallelujah. God, you're worthy. He is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. Hallelujah.
Oh, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
about the greatness of our God. Amen. He made everything that's in it, the birds, the insects, even the icky bugs that you don't like spiders and scorpions and snakes. I wish, really, he could have left those out. Because they do harm to me. Or at least I think they do. Or they will make me do it when I see one. But you know what? He made the oceans only to come so far. They have their boundaries. He made the stars in the sky to shine in greatness for his majesty and for his goodness. But you know what? He made us to worship him. All of that worships him too, but you know what? We have a relationship with him. He created us that he could talk to us. He could speak to us. He could love us. Like he can't love all of that. I mean, he does because he created and he formed it. But man, he loves us enough that he would create us to worship him. One of these days we get to do it before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. This right here is just a rehearsal ground for that grand moment. And man, I can't wait. Because one of these days, truly, we are going to be able to kneel before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We are going to get to tell him face to face how much he means to us, how good he is, how great he is. How about we do that tonight? He is more than words could ever express. When I worship him, I can't help but lift my hands and lift my eyes to the heavens because he's just that good. And he deserves that much praise and that much more. Amen. Holy is he. He is so good to each and every one of us. And I'm sure that all of us has a story that we could tell of the goodness of the Lord. How he has healed our bodies, set us free, delivered us. I see God working in my daughter's life right now. And it's something I've been praying for a long time. It's not finalized yet, but I know he will never fail me. And what he has promised, he will fulfill. Because he's not a God that he should lie. He's never turned his back on me, even though sometimes we do him. He's so faithful, and he's so worthy of our praise. So just lift your hands and just begin to tell him tonight how good he is. You know, sometimes we get busy and caught up in the day's events that we all have to face every day. And sometimes we kind of just forget to tell him how good he is and how much we love him and how much we adore him. That's what you get to do when you come to a body of Christ and we join in together and we lift up one mighty voice to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You're worthy, Father. You are worthy, God. Your love never fails, Father. Your love never fails. We invite you in this place tonight, God. We want to feel your presence. We want to sit at your feet, God. We want to hear your heartbeat, God, and your words that you speak over us, God. We exalt you in this place tonight, God, for your great name. Every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that you are Lord. All of creation worships you, God, and we're going to join in that with that tonight. Oh, come on, one more time. Just lift him up and give him praise. He deserves it. He deserves it.
Lost are saved. Find their way. Sound of your great name, all condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord.
Come on, with your voice, just sing that chorus one more time.
Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God, amen, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Oh,
sing it one more time.
Oh,
your voice,
slain for us. Son of God, amen, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
One of these days, God, they're gonna praise you, Lord, your great name. Lift your hands and giving praise and honor.
We adore you, Lord. We adore you, God. We adore you, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
From the end of the earth will I cry to you, God. When my heart is overwhelmed and fainting, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Yes, a rock that is too high for me. Because, God, we know that you are able. We know, God, that you are more than able, Father. Lead us to the rock, God, that is higher than I. Plant our feet firmly, God, on that solid rock, that we would not be shaken. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name, God. We bless your name, God.
Thank you.
deserves the glory tonight. Amen. As we sing in that song, He is our strong tower. That says the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. We can call upon the name of the Lord for whatever need we have. If you have a need this morning or you know someone in need, raise your hand briefly right where you're standing. If you'll just raise your hand, you know of a need of prayer. Yes, I see that. Let's keep those hands up. Those of you that are around these that have their hands up, would you go to them in prayer? Also, we want to remember Miss Winnell House. We want to remember Miss Dana Farley. God will touch them and bring them out. Amen. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we call upon the name of Jesus that's above every other name, and we ask you to meet every need of everyone that's here tonight in the name of Jesus, name above all names. And Lord, we ask that you touch Miss Winnell. Lord, that you bring her home and that you strengthen her, Lord. And ask that you touch Dana Farley where she's at, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Help her, Lord, with the procedure that she's going through, and strengthen her and help her to heal in the name of Jesus. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. Let's just worship him tonight. Lord, we give you praise and glory and honor for your goodness and for your presence that's in this place. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. You may be seated as our ushers are preparing to take our evening offering. We want to remember this Saturday at 10 o'clock, we have our Life Connection class. Those of you that signed up for it in the foyer or on the form, and you're interested in joining the church and you haven't officially joined, please remember that that is this Saturday. We do have childcare provided for those that need it. And if you haven't signed up, please sign up in the foyer for that as well. Also, we will remember this Sunday, Pastor Danny will be back and he will be ministering. And we look forward to what God has in store for us. Amen. And actually, 2 weeks from yesterday, we will be leaving for Kenya. So any of y'all that are interested in any of the books there, to have your name and to sponsor them with any sponsorship, you get a complimentary book. And we're supplying books, and we're also supplying chairs. So if you'll take a look at that back at the table, and be sure to give that to me after service, I would appreciate it. The Lord bless you. Well, thank you for your faithfulness. In spite of the lightning, we have the lights on. Amen? It's not because of you not giving. Thank you for your faithfulness in all that you do, and the Lord bless you. Okay, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for each one that's here this evening. We ask your blessing be upon them, upon their households, and upon their businesses in the name of Jesus. And thank you for their faithfulness, and we give you glory and honor for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, you have.
How are y'all doing this evening? You came on out in spite of the rain, amen? Praise God. And the electricity hadn't went off during the whole service so far. We're just going to keep believing. I better quit talking about it, amen? Good to see all of you here tonight, amen? And I hope you've come to, I know you've come to receive something from the Lord, and I know you will not leave disappointed. I want to talk about us being content in Him. I want to preach content in Him. If you'll look at Matthew chapter 6, we'll look at verse 24. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, it says, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." I heard as I was growing up, you can't play both sides of the ball game. Amen? You got to choose who you're going to serve. Choose you this day who you will serve, whether it be the gods of Egypt or the gods of this land or the real God. Amen? Jehovah is His name. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen? And Jesus opened this in this chapter, and He went on to say, and I don't have it up on the overhead, but "therefore I say unto you, take no thought of your life what you shall eat," verse 25, "or what you shall drink, nor of your body what you shall put on. Is not life more than meat, and the body more than raiment?" Don't worry about what you're going to eat. Don't worry about what you're going to put on. He said, "Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor do they gather in barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add any one cubit to your stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed as one of them. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which is today is, and tomorrow is cast in the oven, shall He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we be clothed with? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. And your heavenly Father knows you have need of them before you even ask." Hallelujah. "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Take therefore no thought," as it says in verse 34, "take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." You know, we live in a time when we have access to all kinds of things, especially here in America. We're so spoiled. And, you know, before I went on my first trip to India, I had a long list of what I wanted for myself. And when I came back, I realized I lived like a king compared to most of the people in the world. And my list grew very, very short. But now I had a different focus. And, you know, we have children that want the latest thing. They want the iPhone. They want the Xbox. They want this or that because their friend has it, you know. We have all kinds of access to all kinds of creations. And yet we have some of the most discontented. You know, some of you, I say you, maybe me, we played with little cars in the dirt. We played with stick figures. Y'all played with stick figures for dolls. Okay, I didn't play with dolls, okay? I want to make that clear. y'all made mud pies, all that, and you were content with what you had, amen? But now it seems like you go into a kid's room, they almost have to have a playroom full of toys or their room's overflowing with toys, their closet's overflowing. And yet we have a discontented generation. We have all the modern conveniences. We have air conditioning. We have all the wonderful things. Microwave this, you know, quick that, quick this. And yet we're still unhappy and discontent. It's because of where our focus is, amen? And we have to make up our mind that we're going to keep our focus upon the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else falls into place. Speaking of mission trips, you know, the first several that I did, I raised funds, I sold plates, I did everything I could to raise about $3,000 each time that I went. But about the fourth time, the Lord said, "I don't want you to do another thing. I want you to see my hand at work." And so I didn't raise another dime. I didn't advertise. I told about I was going, but I did not do any effort, any work. And believe me, that was hard for me to do because I enjoyed doing it. But people began to come in one after another, and some would hand me 20, and some would hand me 50 and 100. And then I got down to the last wire, and my friend called me and said, "You're going to have to purchase your ticket on Monday." And this was a Saturday. And I did not know how I was going to do that. It was over $700. And I had paid for some other things and raised some money, and I just was waiting and waiting. And an elderly woman that went to our church, a widow woman, she came up to me, drove up to where our parsonage was, and she said, "Nathan, I just wanted to bless you because I got some extra money." And this is a woman who paid $250 rent. She took care of other elderly people. And I just didn't expect her to have a lot of money. And she had handed me 20 before on another mission trip that we went. But God said, you know, "Be still and see that I'm God." Well, she handed me a check, and I put it in my pocket, and I said, "Thank you very much." I prayed with her. She left. I went inside, and I opened the check, and it was for $1,000, just what I needed, and from a source that I didn't expect it to come. Amen. Another time, I was going on a mission trip, and I was leaving the following Monday or Tuesday, and on Saturday, the woman called me and that I knew in the community. She said, "My husband and I want to get with you. I heard you're going on a mission trip, so we'll get with you when you get back." And the Holy Spirit's like, "Be quiet. Don't say a word." So I was like, "Okay, all right, I'll see you later." The next day on Saturday morning, I know she called me. And she said, "My husband wants to come over right away and see you before you leave." I said, "Okay." And so they met me at the church, and he came up to me and says, "We have a gas well on our property, and the Lord has really blessed us, and in the community we've seen what you're doing." And they didn't even go to my church. They went to a little community church up the road. And he says, "But our church, we have like $30,000 in the bank, and we're doing nothing with it." He says, "I want to give this to you." So I put it in my pocket. I prayed with them and asked the Lord to bless them. They left, and I opened it. It was $1,000. God can meet every need. Well, I was rejoicing about this. And I was on the way out the driveway, and I was like, "Oh, God can meet my needs. Ha, ha, ha." You know, I just, "Thank you, Jesus." And he's like, the Holy Spirit says, "Can you trust me for your everyday bread? Can you trust me for your everyday bread?" And believe me, there's been times I've had to do that since then. But God is faithful. He will take care of our every need. Amen? It says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 through 8, it says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, with these shall we be content." You know, Job learned that, realized in the story of Job, that everything he had, everything, but he owned nothing. God blessed him with it. Amen. He said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, naked shall I return." And that's what Paul's telling Timothy, that we brought nothing into this life. We're certainly not going to take anything out of it. And anything that we have is because God has been gracious. God has been good. God has given us the health. God has opened the doors. God has supplied the need. Amen. And we give him glory and we give him honor for that. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Seeking after godliness, seeking after a right standing with God, seeking after his ways, and being content. That is something that's so important for us to understand and learn. It says in 1 Timothy 4, verse 7 and 8, it says, "And exercise yourself towards godliness, for bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having the promise of this life that now is, and that which is to come." So God said that he would take care of us. He said in one scripture that he's given us everything that pertains to life that we now live and to godliness. Amen. And so we can look to the Lord for our strength and our help. We can be content knowing that we have a heavenly Father who loves us with an everlasting love, who will supply all of our needs. Amen. That we have. Some of you might be going through a struggle right now. Turn and look to him. Turn and look to him. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and I promise you all these other things will be added. Every time I tried to fix something, every time I took it into my own hands, I made a mess of it. But every time I released it to God and left it there, God did an awesome job. Amen? We can trust in Him. We can depend upon Him. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, it says, "And let your conversation be without covetousness." And that means let your lifestyle, not just what comes out of your mouth, but everything that exudes your life, let it be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. For He has said, "I will never leave you and I will never forsake you." We have that promise, hallelujah, that God will never leave us. He will never forsake us. Didn't David say in, let's see, I'm going to look at the scripture that I had. I thought I wrote it down. I may not have. "I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread." Amen? God is faithful to His children. Just as you would be faithful to your own child, God much more will be faithful to us. Amen? He will see to it that we have everything we need and then some sometimes. Amen? Sometimes it may not be everything we want. How many of you don't give your child everything they want? Because you know it's not right sometimes, amen? You'd give them anything they can have and anything you can give them, but sometimes you have to say no. God has to say no to us sometimes. We don't understand, but He is faithful, and He will be there for us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. So let our life be without covetousness. Let our lifestyle be that which follows after the Lord. Proverbs 15:16 says, "Better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and trouble therewith." Amen? I'd rather have a little and have contentment. I'd rather have what God wants for me right now instead of looking for the latest and the best and the whatever the world says I'm supposed to have. Amen? If I listened to every commercial, I'd have it my way. Amen? If I listened to every commercial, I should be driving this vehicle. If I listened to every commercial, I should be dressing this way. If I listened to every commercial, I should be living in this type of house or whatever. But better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure with trouble therewith. You know, we're not isolated in our feelings sometimes when we look around us and we see how people prosper who don't serve the Lord. Our neighbors maybe, or someone in our family who just doesn't give a rip about God, but they seem like they're just doing great. Well, we don't live with them 24/7. But it says in Psalm 73, verse 1, "Truly God is good to Israel, to such as are of a pure in heart. But as for me," the psalmist said, "my feet had almost stumbled. My steps were nearly slipped, for I was envious of the boastful. When I saw the prosperity of the wicked, for there are no pangs in their death, but their strength is firm, and there is no trouble as of other men, nor are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes bulge with abundance. They have more than their heart could wish. They scoff and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens." Some of this sound familiar? Amen. You look around and you wonder, why do people get away with what they get away with? "And their tongue walks through the earth. Therefore, His people return, and the waters of a full cup are drained by them. They say, 'How does God know? And if there's knowledge in the Most High?'" I can do whatever I want to do. As God is alive, they kind of make fun of God. And some of you may have dealt with this at work or people in your own family, whatever. And he said, "Behold, these things are the ungodly who are always at ease. They increase in richness. Surely I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands innocent. For all day long I've been plagued and I'm chastened every morning. If I said I will speak thus, behold, I would have been untrue to the generation of your children. When I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me." How many of you looked around and was like, "Lord, come on, I need some help here"? Come on, how many of you have been honest? Sometimes we just say, "Lord, help me. I need some help." Looks like everybody else. If we get our eyes upon this world, which is temporal, everything they have is fleeting. May people who never know Jesus be blessed in this life, because that's the only blessing they'll have. God help them, amen, to know the truth. But he said, I looked at all this and I beheld it. And then it says in the last verse, until I went into the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their end. We have to keep our eyes on God. We have to keep in his presence in order to handle and go through life. Amen? Or else it will overwhelm us. We need to be content in his presence and allow him to guide and direct our steps. And know that he is our strength, that he is always there, that he will meet every need. If I put his kingdom first in my life, if I seek his righteousness in all that I do, if I do what is right according to the word of God, God will be faithful to me. That I can stand on that. I can believe in that. I can hope in that. And God is faithful. David said, my feet almost slipped when I looked at the wicked, until I went to the sanctuary of God, then I understood therein. Luke chapter 12, verse 15 says, and he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness, Jesus said. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of things which he possesseth. You, right after this, he began the parable or the story of the rich man who had so much abundance that he tore down his barns and he built bigger. And then he said, then I will say of my soul, take ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But the Lord said, you fool, tonight your soul is required of thee. Whose will these things be after you're gone? That we're here for God's service, amen? Anything he gives us and blesses us with, it's for his kingdom and his glory, amen? And we cannot, we can enjoy life. Yes, God blesses us in many different ways, but we need to have our contentment in him, regardless of whether the bank account is this full or it's that low. Amen. We need to be content in him, whether we have the best job or we're looking for the job. Amen. We need to have trust and faith and confidence in him, regardless of what we're going through, knowing that he is our provider. Amen. Philip, y'all are really quiet on me. I'm trying my best. Philippians chapter 4, verse 11. It says, not that I speak in respect of want. Paul said, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. Now, if there was someone in the New Testament who could say that, it would be Paul. Because he faced all kinds of persecutions. He faced all kinds of oppositions, natural and by people and from the enemy. Amen. And he went through all kinds of things. And he said in the next verse, I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere I am and in all things, I'm instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. In the last verse, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, we like to quote that last verse, but realize the context of what Paul was saying. I learned how to do everything through Christ's strength. Regardless of what is going on around me, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God is our strength. God is our help. Amen. And Paul learns, he said, to abound and to be abased and to be full, to be hungry, all those things through the strength of the Lord. Matthew chapter 16, and we'll close with this scripture. It says, then said Jesus to his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what profit is it if a man gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? The thing we are rich with is the blessings that Christ has given us. We are really seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We have access through the boldness that we should have to come before the throne of God with every need that we have in our life, or to praise him or to worship him. We are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We're part of the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God has no lack, amen, for his children. And so we can trust him. We can rest in him. And if any man will follow him in this life, we're going to have to put a cross to the flesh. We're going to have to say no sometimes to things that are comfortable or that we want. But we're going to have to follow after him. And it says, anyone who denies himself and takes up his cross to follow me. Another scripture I thought of, and I thought of it when I went to India with this missionary. She had given up being with her family. Her mother needed her care, and she had to have a sister come in and step in and help her. And she was, I believe, 68 years old, and she felt the call to India at that point in her life. And there's a scripture that Jesus says, no one has forsaken mother, daughter, fathers, brothers, land, all these things, that I will not reward them even greater in the kingdom of heaven. And I thought of her every time I read that scripture, because I haven't done much suffering or forsaking things in this life. But she just turned everything over to God and went where God told her to go. And I wonder if we are in that position where we can say, Lord, I'm content in you. I rest in you. I depend upon you to be my strength and my help. And I am content. Whatever situation I'm in, I trust you implicitly as the musicians come tonight. Hallelujah. I rest in the Lord. The Psalms 23 that we know so well says this, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And that means I shall not have any lacking in my life. Why? Because he's my shepherd. I'm his sheep. He's going to take care of me. He leads me beside the still waters. He lets me lay down in green pastures. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, he is there with me. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. And he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. My cup runs over. I don't have any lack because I am in him. I trust him. And I want you to get to that point tonight. If some of you are wavering, if some of you are going through something, that you trust him implicitly with whatever you're facing. No matter what it might be, no matter what lacking you might have in your life, you've learned that whatever you go through, Jesus Christ will give you strength to go through it. Jesus Christ will be your provider. Would you stand with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you that you're faithful to us. Lord, that you provide for us in so many ways. Lord, we're content in you. You're our help. You're our strength. You're the one we look to. You're the one we depend upon. Hallelujah. Lord, there's nothing we can do to add any height to ourselves. There's sometimes we're at the end of finances, that we're at the end of what we have in resources. But Lord, you are our strength and you are our help. And we turn to you. We seek first your kingdom. We seek first your righteousness, that you might be glorified in the name of Jesus. Let's just worship with them as the worship team sings. Let's sing with them and worship the Lord for a while. Just go into his presence. Let him minister to you tonight. Troubles vanish. Oh, let him do what he desires tonight in your life. Let's sing it again with her. Hallelujah. Let's worship him. He's truly worthy. place tonight. If there's someone here tonight that may have a need, maybe it's not in necessarily along our lines of speaking tonight, but you want us to pray with you, I want to make this area up here open. We can agree together. When we come together, the Bible says for us to pray one for another. Amen. Whatever your need is, this is open up here. If you'll come briefly up here, we'll gather around you and pray for whatever the need is, and then we'll wait just a moment. Hallelujah. Anyone desire prayer tonight? Hallelujah. Yes, God is faithful. Hallelujah. Anyone else, you have a need, whatever it might be. You want to stand in for somebody, whatever it might be. God's faithful. Hallelujah. Amen. Just stand up here. Hallelujah. Anyone else? We're waiting. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's sing that one more time. And if you want prayer, whatever we get through, sing it. We'll pray with you. Those of you that are back there still, if you would just come on forward and stand in behind some of these, we'll want to agree with each one of them in prayer. Just feel free to come. We open this up to everyone that will come and pray with us. Sing that one more time to this family. Hallelujah. Let's just worship the Lord tonight for His answers, for these that have called upon Him, for His goodness to us. continues to play this evening, let's just give God a good praise for all He's done. Thank you, Lord God, for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, hallelujah, for touching and ministering tonight. Thank you, Lord, that we can rest upon you, that we can depend upon you. We give you praise, Lord, that our contentment does not depend upon what's going on around us. Our contentment is in you. Lord, we look to you for our strength and our help. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Y'all shake some hands and hug some necks tonight. Don't forget, Sunday, Pastor will be here ministering. You want to be a part of that. Amen. God bless you.
Play it on the keyboard all day long, though.